Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. I hope everyone is well and safe. I know that I heard that API Days had some issue with the platform, and they were quite quick in kind of restoring everything. So my name is Stéphane. I'm based out of Paris area. I'm part of the Noname Security Solution Architecture team. Really happy to be here. Of course, I would have preferred to do that live and to have some direct interaction, but yeah, obviously the health situation is not easy. So maybe just as a word of introduction, this is not a product demo session. This is more like an agnostic workshop. Obviously, I'm convinced that Noname Security has the best security platform to protect against APR threats. But I will try during this session to make it as neutral as possible and rather focus on the risk associated with API and showcase some of them through a small lab that we are going to use all together. I will also give you the guidelines so you can basically do the setup after the session by yourself. And yeah, obviously, more than happy to welcome any question after that. So let's have a look at the agenda. We'll start with a brief overview of the API security landscape and highlight a couple of things that are making API security the hottest topic today in the security world. Then I will go and showcase the lab that we have prepared for you and explain the different components that we are going to use. And we will be using this lab to do a live demo and illustrate some API breaches in the lab. So I hope everything will work well. I have instances in AWS, but apparently everything was fine this morning when I checked last. Last but not least, I will conclude by presenting you an API security strategy that we believe as an organization that all enterprise should consider when it comes to thinking about API security posture. Okay, so let's get started. So why is it so urgent? Why API security is so hot on the market? I mean, obviously, needless to explain to you that API are really at the heart of any digital business today. Any modern pipeline is based on API in the modern world. Akamai was stating that something more than 80% of the web traffic today is API-based. And if you talk to a large enterprise, they are all seeing API integration as a key component of their digital transformation. When it comes to developers, we see that developers are under a huge pressure to accelerate the delivery cycle and to get release out faster and faster. So they are executing on that. And sometimes they don't have always the time, or they don't always take the time to go through the security check and do the proper documentation and the proper documentation update. And if I relate that to what we do at Noname and the different customer deployment we are executing on, we typically see something in the like of 30% of APIs in the customer environment that are actually not identified initially by the customer before deploying Noname. And for many of them, we see some deprecated APIs, but also some APIs that are lacking documentation. So documentation is often done initially, but there is not always a full life cycle to track all the modification on APIs. At the end of the day, it is all about the data, as you all know. And the main concern today, when we speak to customers, is that they are really getting challenged to understand where the data are being exposed. So for instance, one of the difficult questions to answer is, which of my APIs are currently exposing some GDPR-related data? And most of the customers we are talking to are reaching out to us because they are not able to answer this question. Okay, so I extracted this quote from one of the Gartner study, and this is I think quite an old study that they did probably two, 3 years ago. And actually, it seems that they were quite spot on, maybe a bit late, and they were maybe a bit conservative because we believe that it's already the case in 2021. API is already the number one attack surface for enterprise web application. So if I want to illustrate that with a couple of examples, every week we see a new article regarding an API breach. One that caught my attention back in October is the one that impacted a company called BrewDog. So BrewDog is a company that is dealing with IPA beer production. And what happened is that a research team at Pentest Partners discovered that their mobile application was actually embedding a hard-coded API token. And basically, they were able to leverage the static token, which obviously is going against all the best practices for mobile app development. And those guys at Pentest Partners, they were able to leverage this API token in order to dump quite a large amount of data of the customer database of BrewDog. Obviously, this was a big concern with regard to the fact that BrewDog is looking to go IPO in 2022. So this is just one example among others, not to throw the developer under the bus, but obviously this is something quite common, and we have seen a lot of similar examples in the past, and I'm sure we'll continue to see others like this in the next months. So when it comes to the community, and maybe we can put a little spot on the Open Web Application Security Project, also known as OWASP. And maybe for those that follow the session of my colleague Carl an hour ago, I believe he mentioned that. What happened in 2019, the OWASP, that is actually at the origin of a very well-known top 10, which typically applies to web application firewall. And this top 10 has been the reference for web application security for more than 15 years, if I recall correctly. The OWASP decided that the API security topic is serious enough and complex enough to have its own top 10. So in November 2019, they came up with a new top 10 specific to API, and I have listed the issues here. Those issues are covering 99% plus of the known API security risk, and definitely is becoming the de facto standard for organization to deal and to design a proper API security framework. So one could wonder, why do we need a specialized solution to tackle the API security problem? And probably a good answer can be to look at the number one OWASP top 10 issue, which is called BOLA, Broken Object Level Authorization. And when you look at the typical flow in a BOLA issue, and maybe before that, I should explain what a BOLA is for those that are not comfortable with this concept. And I like to make the analogy with a BOLA issue in an API and what is happening in a hotel. So typically, if you are checking into a hotel, you will issue your passport and your credit card. You will get authenticated. And in return, the front desk will deliver you a room key, which is giving you access to your room. But obviously, if you are booked into room 201, with this room key, you should not have access to room 302. Okay. And if this is happening, obviously, the hotel authorization model has an issue because you would get access to the property of someone else. And this is exactly what is happening when it comes to a BOLA issue. You typically have a user that is typically authenticating against, let's say, an API gateway and potentially against a system. And this user in return will get, let's say, an authentication token in return. But because of some backend being not properly implemented in terms of authorization, he will be able to access to its data. Here you have data in yellow in the diagram. But unfortunately, he will also be able to leverage this token to access the data of some other folks. And this is the typical illustration of a Ebola issue. A user that is successfully authenticated against the system is able to go and access some data which typically should be unauthorized for him and against which he should get an HTTP 401 code as an example. So the problem with that is that you cannot look simply at individual transaction, and you need to have the ability to look at the business context, and you need to understand the business logic of your API in order to counter and in order to detect this type of threat. And that's why the traditional security solutions that are dealing with API, such as API Gateway or even Web Application Firewall, are not suited to deal with API security because they typically look at individual transactions and they are lacking the business content, the context of the application. I will leave some time for a question after the session. So feel free to drop them in the chat and I will make sure that we can review them before the end of the session. Okay, so that's it for the API security landscape, and hopefully it gives you a bit of insight on the sense of urgency and where we are today. Then I would like to move to the second part, and I would like to go into the lab. First of all, I'd like to introduce the small lab that we have deployed here. So I'm using some very common component to run the lab, so leveraging Docker, leveraging Git and Postman and Curl, so very very popular tool. In order to have an API gateway, I choose to use Kong and leveraging a Cassandra database as a backend for the Kong gateway, but could have been another API gateway, of course. And I have deployed a very nice framework that has been built and that is available on GitHub, and I will make sure to give you the link after the session, which is called Vempy, which obviously is a perfect example of a vulnerable API, and we are going to play with the Vempy framework in order to showcase some vulnerabilities. Obviously, we have an API gateway in place, so we are going to configure the gateway, and I have already done that to facilitate the lab, and I have leveraged two functionality. One is rate limiting, and the second one is obviously I have implemented authentication on the Kong gateway. So this is a kind of rough overview of my setup. So maybe we can switch to the lab. I'm going to share my other screen. Okay, so I'm connected to my Ubuntu machine. Okay, so we are going to check first that everything is properly up and running. So as mentioned, I have three containers here on that machine. I have my API gateway. I have the backend database that I am using to store the Kong data. And obviously another container that is running the vulnerable API leveraging Vempy. Okay. Obviously I have a direct access to the Vempy API. And in this case, I'm not going through the API gateway. So I'm just proving it by using a curl on port 5000. And you can see here a small check message that is showing me the access to the vulnerable APIs. And I'm going to do the exact same thing, but in the second case, I'm going to use the route and the service that I exposed through the Kong gateway. So just to show you, if I am not entering any API key, here I'm not able to access the API. So I need to basically rerun my my command, but I'm going to use an API key in the key there. So the API key is very simple. It's actually API key as a string. And in this case, as you can see, I get the same check message showing the vulnerable API, but you can notice some additional headers here. One is obviously showing Kong-related header, and we have like a measurement of the latency. And more important, we see some headers that have been added by Kong with regard to rate limiting, and this is the rate limiting that I have configured for this specific service on the Kong gateway. Okay, so everything is running properly here. We have our API gateway. We have our vulnerable API exposed directly just for the sake of the example, but also exposed behind the API gateway, leveraging authentication and rate limiting. Okay, cool. So I'm going to use another tool now, and I'm going now to move to Postman, so we can play a bit with the API, and I'm going to show you a couple of examples of API breaches here using this small lab. So, okay, seems to be okay. So first of all, let me do a short presentation of the Postman collection. So we have a Postman collection here called LabVampy here. And obviously, this collection is leveraging an authentication method based on API key, as you can see here. Okay, so obviously, I've already entered my key pair value for the API key, so the same as the one I've been using to do the test on the Ubuntu machine. Okay, and then the first one that we are going to look together is related to a broken object level authorization. So my API is actually populated with a sample database, which actually contains a list of books. Each and every single book has an owner, and an owner is actually a user in my database. And for each owner, I also have a secret information that is tied to this owner. Okay. So first of all, we are going to check connectivity to the vulnerable API using the Kong exposure. So I'm using port 8000 as before and slash V1, okay, for my API. Okay, so the connectivity seems to work properly, and I'm getting the check message that we saw previously. Okay, and then I'm going to use another unauthenticated command in order to retrieve the list of books that are in my database. It's a very simple database, as you can see. I have a few books here. Book one is called book title 16 and is belonging to username 1. Book title 97 is belonging to username 2. Okay. So now we have the ability to authenticate and to log in to this vulnerable API. Okay. So for that, I need to use some credential on top of the API key at the API level. So I'm going to log in as username 1, and password is pass 1 here. Okay. So here I am properly authenticated against my API, and in return, the API is delivering me an authentication token. Okay. So I'm going to copy this token, and I'm going to use it in another call, which give me the ability to retrieve books in the database. So you see that this call is authenticated because obviously if I try to run this call without configuring anything, there is clearly a message stating that I am missing something with regard to the token. And you see that the authentication method here is using a bearer token. Okay. So I'm going to configure the token, and I'm going to paste the token that I got through the previous authentication phase. Okay. And then I'm going to retrieve the information for book title 16, which is the one that I own. So book title 16 belongs to username 1, which is the user that I use to authenticate against the API. And here, as a result, I get the information with regard to book title 16, and I also get the secret information for book title 16. So far, so good. However, now I can try to change the path variable, and I'm going to enter another book. I'm going to enter book title 97, which doesn't belong to username 1, if you recall. And unfortunately, we have here the perfect example of Ebola. I am authenticated against the vulnerable API using the token that was issued to username 1 with a proper password authentication. And I am able to retrieve information of a data that is belonging to another user in the database. So this is the perfect example of a Ebola issue that you can find in API. This means that in the code, there is no check on the owner or on the user when a query is being made. And if you look further after the session at the vulnerable API, you will see clearly the two examples of a proper implementation and a non-correct implementation. And you have a very simple example showcasing you the fact that the API is not checking the user to manage this call. Okay, so that was an example of a Ebola issue. I'm going to go and showcase another example, and we are going to look at another vulnerability in this API that is related to the ability to change the password of another user. Okay, so I'm going to use the same API, and we are going to make another test and another small lab. So first of all, I'm going to log into the API just to check the connectivity again. So still getting the message. Everything is working properly. I'm still getting access to the vulnerable API here. Okay. Then I have another call that is not authenticated and it's giving me access to the list of users. Okay, so I have for each user the email. So I have user the same user as before, name one, and username name two, and another user and a few others. Okay, so here, so far so good. And now I'm going to log in again to the vulnerable API. So I'm using a post and I'm going to authenticate as user name one again. I'm using my password, pass one. Authentication is successful here. And in return, I'm getting an authentication token. So I'm going to copy this token. And I'm going to use this token with a call that is providing me the ability to update user password. So this call requires a valid API token. And if we check here, the token is not properly filled. If I try the call, obviously, the token is stated as being invalid and I'm not able to do anything. So I'm going to paste the valid token that I got by authenticating myself as username one. Okay. But instead of changing my password, I'm going to try and change the password of another user. I'm going to try and change the password of username two in the system. So just for sake of kind of reality, I'm just checking at the clock. It's 16:01 on my MacBook. So I'm going to index this with 16:01. I'm going to try the update password call. Okay, so I get an HTTP message, an HTTP response code being 204. So apparently the server did process the request successfully, but I don't get any data in return. So I have actually a way to check that. And I'm going to check using a debug route that is available in my API. And now, as we can see, we have the database that is also with the debug route. I'm able to see the password of each and every single user. And as a result, if I check username name two, I can see that the password change happened properly. And I was able, as user name one, I was able to change the password of username two. So this is another example of API vulnerability, where a user that got properly authenticated against an API got authentication token and is now able to manipulate data of someone else. So hopefully it was useful. And maybe as a bonus, we have actually a third vulnerability here, or third item that belongs to the OWASP top 10, because obviously this type of, you know, underscore debug type of code is typically related to excessive data exposure. You obviously don't want to have this type of call being available. And this is something that can happen when API are being tested. Developer might implement a specific route for temporary testing. And because of the rush and because of the pressure, they might forget to remove the route. And in some case, when deploying the Donnelly platform, we came across this type of route where we see some routes that are not documented in the API documentation and in the Open API spec typically, and actually leading to some excessive data exposure as the one here. Okay. So everything worked well on the lab. So we are going to move to the last part of the session. I'm going to share my screen again. Okay, so just wanted, before we move forward, I wanted to share the link to the detailed setup of the workshop. Credits are going to my colleague and friend Steven Duquert, who is also part of the solution architecture team at Noname, and who has built most of the framework here, and I've been leveraging that one. So I thought you would find it useful to get access to the framework, and you have all the step-by-step instruction in order to rebuild this lab either on a Linux machine or even on a laptop that is running Docker. Okay. So as the last part, I'm going to talk about API security strategy to conclude. And our view at Noname, and somehow this is not a product related view, this is more a framework, and this is more a strategy that we believe enterprise should embrace when it comes to dealing with API security. And this strategy falls into three main pillars. Everyone in the industry today is kind of converging around the fact that we need runtime security for API. And runtime security means that for each and every single API in your environment, you want to be able to build a baseline for this API. You want to be able to analyze the behavior of this API, understand the API schema of the requests and the responses, and you want to understand whenever something abnormal is happening and whenever someone is trying to breach your API or launch an attack against one or more API. So this is obviously a key component of the API security strategy. However, this is not enough. And we believe that equally, there is a huge emphasis that should be given to what we call posture management. And somehow, you don't only want to look at your API and to do some runtime analysis of your API. but you also want to analyze the API in its context, and you want to understand the posture, which means that we need to understand how the API is exposed to the outside world. Is the API accessible from the internet? Is the API actually accessed from the internet? How many users are actually consuming this API? Is it only a single machine that is actually consuming this API? Is it are there thousands of users that are actually consuming it? Do we have direct access to this API from the internet, or are we going through other infrastructure components such as a load balancer, an API gateway? Do we have like an identification of the owner? Do we have some additional data? For instance, can we relate this API to a specific AWS or Azure cloud account? Can we have some additional information from the infrastructure standpoint? And maybe we also want to assess the security of the components that are in the chain. Do we have rate limiting? Do we have authentication in place? Do we have a proper setup with regard to the API gateway? Is the underlying server properly set up without any vulnerability in the system modules? These are all the questions one might ask and one might want to assess when it comes to API security. And this is why we believe we should go beyond the sole fact of analyzing the API, but also analyze the full chain of connectivity that is giving access to this API. Last but not least, we see a lot of organizations that are willing to embrace a shift left posture with regard to their DevOps organization. And they are looking to be more efficient and more proactive in testing the security posture of their API before this API or this new version of an API is going into production. So the third pillar of the API security strategy we believe in should provide the ability to secure APIs during the development in an automated manner before those API or those versions of your API are going into production. With those three pillars, we believe that customer will be able to get 360 degrees of security coverage for their API estate. So how do we implement that at Noname? And I will make a brief overview of the product components. We basically have four key modules in the Noname platform. And this implementation is obviously an answer to the API security strategy I just presented. And this is called DART, Discovery, Analysis, Remediation, and Test. So let's go through these four modules very briefly. So the first one is around discovery. So obviously, we are providing the ability to discover all API in your environment. Should there be behind an API gateway, or should they be directly exposed without an API gateway? And the key principle for doing this discovery is to be out of band and to be frictionless. So we don't want to create any risk for the business application. So we are always running in a mode where basically we are not impacting the application. We also want to be able to understand the schema of those API that we discover, and especially we want to understand which type of data are being consumed by those APIs, and whether this type of data are sensitive, confidential, maybe related to PII type of data. By doing this discovery and by analyzing the traffic, we also strive to provide an inventory and a full up-to-date documentation of the API estate. And we are basically building a dynamic open API specification for each and every single API that we discover based on the actual traffic. Then what matters is also be able to track API changes over time. We are no longer in a world where APIs were only a few in the information system and they were very static. We are in an environment where we have hundreds and sometimes thousands or tens of thousands of APIs, and those APIs can change very frequently. So you need to have a way to keep track of every changes that is happening on each and every single API with regard to the data type that are being exposed and consumed. Last but not least, as I explained before, you also want to understand the API in its ecosystem. So can we relate an API? Can we map an API to a specific owner? Can we map an API to a use case? Is it a production API? Is it a dev API? Is it using a specific set of compute resources, etc., etc.? So we want to have as much insight as possible, and we are providing as much insight as possible with regard to the API we discover. Once we have, and maybe just before we move to the second step, some examples. So here you have like a Swagger UI that is providing access to all the real-time documentation of the API that we have discovered. And I'm not sure it's big enough, unfortunately, but you can see all the data types that are being consumed, and you can basically select one or more data type in order to have a view of which API are consuming which type of data in your API estate. Obviously, we have the ability to build and to analyze and to understand the API schema from a request standpoint, but also from a response standpoint. Okay. Another thing that is important before moving to the analysis part, as I mentioned earlier, we try to understand the API in its infrastructure context. And here I have two anonymized examples from live deployment, where we see that actually an API is exposed behind a public IP here with an EC2 instance. So in one case, the access is provided through a load balancer. I believe the use case was in AWS, if I recall correctly. But also, we discovered that the same API was also directly exposed through the internet. So the same public IP that was actually routed through the load balancer is also exposed directly on the internet. So typically, this is not a best practice. And this is a typical case that we would illustrate in a graph in the product, such as the one I'm showing you right now. But we would also raise that as an issue in the platform, as we are going to talk about it. So the second piece is obviously the analysis. We want to understand the API as a whole. We want to understand the context and the business logic. We want to be able to analyze the API spec. We also want to give the ability to compare the dynamic spec, if I can call it so, with the theoretical spec that was previously defined by the developer when the API was created. Then we also want to look at misconfiguration from a posture standpoint. We are looking at hundreds of typical misconfiguration, like issue with rate limiting, lack of authentication, some direct access, as I mentioned earlier on. Then for each and every single API, we are doing this runtime security that we spoke about. We are leveraging an unsupervised machine learning model to do that, and we are leveraging artificial intelligence in order to build a baseline for each and every single API, analyze the behavior, and be able to spot any deviation from the behavior that we have analyzed. So obviously, this is a continuous analysis process that is happening. So we are looking at the API, we are looking at the profile of the user, the profile of the traffic, and the type of data that are being exposed and consumed. And last but not least, from an analysis standpoint, we are going to relate those issues to the OWASP API top 10 that I introduced previously. Just a couple of examples to illustrate that. So obviously here you have the mapping of the issue with the OWASP top 10 and two anonymized examples. Here, one example that was related to a broken object level authorization, where we were typically seeing some discrepancy between a specific URI field and the content of a JWT payload from an authentication standpoint, and a kind of a large variety of requests trying to basically crawl the database. Then we have here another type of issue as another example. We obviously can bring up some issue with regard to data policy compliance. So whenever some data are being exposed and these data are considered as sensitive or personal information and they should not be exposed on a specific API or on a specific group of API, we are going to raise an issue in the platform. So raising an issue is leading us to the next topic, which is remediation. You obviously want to have the red alerts and the red lights happening on your dashboard, but you also want to have a smooth and transparent integration of the platform with existing tools in your IT environment. So the platform has the ability to integrate natively with SIEM solution, such as Splunk or QRadar or some others. And we also have the ability to integrate natively with ticketing systems such as ServiceNow or to products such as Jira in order to automatically create some tickets whenever an issue is discovered. It can also be done from an administrative standpoint by someone looking at the no-name console and deciding to create a ticket. So all the options are available. And last but not least, we are also able to integrate and collaborate with API Gateway or Load Balancer in order to update rules in a dynamic manner to deliver an active remediation process. In this case, we are going to be able to block an API, block an IP, or block a user, depending on the use case. And we are able to do that again in an automated manner or using the console of the monitoring platform. So obviously all of this is going through a continuous reporting with some dual side integration with Jira for instance. Last point, and just maybe before some example and some screenshot here, we have like a ServiceNow incident being created from the console and everything is pre-populated. And then we are moving to the testing. So again, back to my shift left topic, we want to provide our customers with the ability to test API before those API are being deployed in production. And we want to help them identifying any change that could introduce vulnerability in those APIs. And when it comes to do testing, you obviously want this to be fully automated. And the best way to do that is to integrate with a continuous integration chain. And with regard to testing, testing is a very difficult topic, obviously. There is a lot of things that you need to consider. If you want to check, for instance, a Ebola type of issue, you obviously need to have users, you need to have objects related to those users, and you need to run a specific set of tests in order to showcase the Ebola issue. And that's definitely one of the hardest topics to tackle. So we are putting a lot of effort at Noname with regard to testing. And we have actually the biggest API research team, API security research team on the market today. So some example again with a few screenshots. So we integrate with most of the popular CI/CD platform of the market, as you can see. And we are providing the admin with some very easy to use dashboard in order to understand what's the status of the different tests and also the ability to run those tests in an automated manner throughout the CI integration. That's it for the API strategy and the way Noname is dealing with this API strategy. Hopefully it was useful. I'm just conscious of the time. I think we have still 5 minutes to take a few questions. So I'm going to look at the chat pod. So feel free to drop any question in the chat if you wish. We still have like 5 minutes to tackle them. Otherwise, you can also book us for a one-to-one conversation if you wish. We are still around either on the virtual booth or also using the meeting system and the direct chat. So if you wish to have like a more detailed conversation, we'd be more than happy to organize that during the API Day event or even afterwards if needed. Okay, so last call for maybe one question. Okay, otherwise I will give you back 5 minutes to have a good coffee or a good tea. And I would like to thank you for attending the session. I hope it was useful. You obviously have all the instruction in order to rebuild the lab by yourself and try it out with the different components that we explained previously. Feel free also to drop me an email if you have any question regarding the lab. I would be more than happy to discuss with you about your findings and maybe any question you could have with regard to maybe your real life environment. So thanks again for joining. Stay safe, everyone, and have a happy holiday season. Thank you very much.